Hello everyone, my name is Calvin Aaron D'Souza and I'm going to explain to you today the ion exchange chromatography technique. So ion exchange chromatography technique comes under a type of column chromatography, and column chromatography, the basic idea of column chromatography is you have a column or a tube, or you can say like a column wherein which you have the stationary phase, which is solid in nature, and the stationary phase. Through the stationary phase, you have the mobile phase, which is liquid or a fluid, which can pass through the solid stationary phase and get separated accordingly. So these chromatography techniques, as any other chromatography technique, is usually used for separation of molecules. And in this case, you have separation of charged macromolecules. That is what it is employed for. And macromolecules could be nucleic acid or proteins, or even amino acids could be used. This technique was initially developed to demineralize water. So water that is usually hard and usually has a lot of many minerals or many toxic chemicals is usually filtered with this technique, and that is the reason why this technique was initially developed. So it helps to filter hard water and remove all of the minerals and convert it to soft water, which is drinkable. Today, this technique is most commonly used for the separation of charged proteins. And this charge, as it's an ion-based technique, it usually needs to be the samples or the stationary phase has to be charged. So that is why we used, in this case, we use a charged protein for separation. This technique, as I said, takes advantage of the charge of the sample, and on the basis of the charge, it undergoes the separation of the sample. So there are like as any chromatography technique, you have two phases. So you have the stationary phase. In this case, the stationary phase is a solid stationary phase. It consists of resin beads, and these resin beads are polymers, and this polymer can either be cellulose polymer, agarose, or even polyacrylate. So these beads are covalently bonded to charged functional groups so that the stationary phase that is there can be even charged along with that of the sample. The charged beads that are there, they are surrounded by these mobile counter ions, and these mobile counter ions are nothing but just the we technically add them to the beads before we run the sample. So this charged stationary phase is usually has the beads to which covalently bonded is the charged functional groups, and then you have these you have these mobile counter ions which are added, and I'll explain them how it basically is. So this is, for example, you have this. This is the bead that you have. This is the resin bead. To this is covalently bonded your charge functional group, which is completely attached to that of the bead. So these charge groups are there. Then you have the mobile counter ions, and if you have a charge positively charged functional group attached to that of the bead, then obviously the mobile counter ions that should be used are negatively charged, so that they attract and they are bonded ionically to or electrostatically to that of the charge groups. Thereafter that you have the mobile phase. The mobile phase is again liquid in nature, and the mobile phase usually has a buffer solution. This buffer solution may contain the charge sample, and this buffer solution is set at a particular required pH. So the charge sample could be either the protein or the nucleic acid. This mobile phase is allowed to run or pass through that of the column, that is the stationary phase that I discussed, and the column contains the charge beads. So on the basis of the affinity to the charge beads, the ion exchange can take place. And it is very much necessary that this mobile phase or the buffer that is used is aqueous or polar or hydrophilic in nature, and that is one, you can say, disadvantage of the ion chromatography technique, or in a way advantage as well, because it only helps for separation of aqueous or polar samples. So you have the buffer and the charged sample that could be either the protein, nucleic acid, or amino acid. Thereafter that you add the mobile phase or the buffer and the charge sample through the column or the ion column, and you allow it to pass through it and undergo the separation accordingly. So there are now two distinct types of ion chromatography techniques and ion exchange chromatography techniques. So one of them is the cation exchanger, another one is the anion exchanger. And the cation exchanger usually tends to have these proton groups, positively charged groups that I discussed, they are usually exchanged with that of the sample. So if you have a positively charged protein, the positively charged protein would get exchanged easily with that of the charge group, and the positively charged protein will now sit in this place, whereas this particular charge group will come in the place of the protein, and this charge group will then get eluted out and leave the column, because this charge group that is used is kind of weakly positively charged, and this protein tends to be, it's a bigger macromolecule, so it tends to exchange with the smaller charge group very easily. Whereas on the other hand, if you have a negatively charged protein, the negatively charged protein obviously would not have any much affinity to that of the negatively charged functional group that is attached to the bead. So it would mostly repel. So this exchange is not very likely to happen. So that's why this the negative protein that is there would get eluted out along with the exchanged positively charged groups. On the other hand, it's very much opposite to that of your cation exchanger. Your anion exchanger has positively charged functional groups, and the negatively charged mobile counterion that is there, it is attached ionically to that of the functional groups. Now in this case, if you have a negatively charged protein, the protein would mechanically undergo, like it's very very logical that it would able to undergo exchange with that of the negatively charged group that is attached. And because again, I explained, like this is less electronegative in nature, and this is more higher in weight, so it would easily undergo the exchange. Here in this case, if you would have a positive protein, the positive protein obviously would not undergo the exchange, because it would repel with that of the positive functional group that is there. So chances of this exchange happening is very unlikely. So this, it's pretty much obvious from this diagram that you would usually use cation exchanger when your target sample or the protein sample that you are wishing to separate is positively charged. On the other hand, you would use an anion exchanger when your protein that you wish to separate or you wish to get stuck to that of the stationary phase is negatively charged. So before going ahead, we would really have to know what happens, like how is this technique kind of regulated. So you would have to know what are proteins. So proteins are basically made of amino acids, and these amino acids are known as Zwitter ions. So Zwitter ions is like a term that is used for any ion or any molecule that tends to have either a positive or either a negative charge, depending on whether depending on the pH of the solution it is kept in. So if the pH of the solution is positively charged, it would enable the ion to have certain charges. So in this case, I have taken just the general amino acid structure. So you have like the R alkyl group that is there, and you have the carboxyl group, you have amino group, and you have the methyl group. So in this case, what I'm basically trying to explain here is that when you have both positive, that is here you have the positively charged amino group and negatively charged carboxyl group. In this case, you have both positive and negative charges. So positive, negative will, like you can say, negate each other, and you will have in total, you will have net zero charge. So this particular point wherein which your amino acid has this zero charge is called as the isoelectric point, and it's designated by Pi. On the other hand, if your pH lowers like by a few degrees, so if your pH is lower, then the you can say the H plus ions are in higher numbers. So H plus ions would undergo protonation of that of the amino groups, and if the amino groups are protonated, then your and you will see the NH3 plus, but you wouldn't see COO minus. So COO will get again protonated with H. So this would not have any charge, but here you would have the positive charge. So this protein as a whole is having a net positive charge, and this is designated by pKa1. And on the other hand, again, if the pH is increased, so if the pH is increased, you will have higher number of OH minus groups, and OH minus groups tend to undergo deprotonation of the amino acid. So your H that was usually here is now taken up by the OH minus ions, and even here the H that was there is taken up. So you have here a neutral amino group that has no charge, but here you have the H that is removed. So this becomes a negatively charged group, and as a whole, it is now a negatively charged amino acid. So in this way, your amino acid has three different states, and this is what is known as the Zwitter ion. Now, the use of this zwitter ions is basically if you have like many different proteins have different zwitter ions. So, as we know, proteins are made up of amino acids. So, it's usually they say that if you have majority of the amino acids having a positive charge, then the protein as a whole or the whole macromolecule is considered to have a positive charge. Or if the majority of the proteins have majority of the amino acid have a zero charge or isoelectric point, then the protein as a whole has an isoelectric point. So when we say a protein has a zero charge or isoelectric point, it doesn't mean that all of the amino acids are zero charge, but just you can say majority of them, or more than 50% of the amino acid in the protein are zero charge. So let's say if the target protein that we are wishing, like we want to separate, is having an isoelectric point or pi of about 5 pH. So if we are using a pH buffer or pH solution having that pH that is used for the mobile phase, if the pH is, you can say, higher than that of 5. So if the pH is higher than that of 5, as I explained earlier, if the pH is higher, then that means that the OH minus groups will be in higher numbers. So deprotonation of the amino and carboxyl groups will take place. And technically, if the deprotonation takes place, you have the protein having negative charge altogether. On the other hand, if the pH of the solution in which the protein is kept, that is, we are talking of the protein having isoelectric point of 5, if the pH is lower than that, then your protein obviously will undergo protonation. So you will have more hydrogen groups attached to the amino and carboxyl groups, and the protein as a whole will have a positive charge. So in this way, you can depending on whether you alter the pH of the sample, you can get different. You can get either the protein to have a positive charge and either a negative charge. But always this depends on the isoelectric point. As explained, if the pH is higher, you get the protein of a negative charge, and if the protein is negatively charged, then that can be used for ion exchange chromatography because this protein will be more likely to undergo exchange with that of the negatively charged mobile counter ion. And here on the cation exchange chromatography, if you have if the pH is decreased such that your it is decrease is lesser than that of the pi, so the protein is now positively charged, and this positively charged protein can undergo exchange with the positively charged ion. So now this can be used, like you the more preferable technique for this particular type of situation is the cation exchange chromatography. So the working for the ion exchange chromatography is pretty much simple now, since we have already learned about the basic principle behind the technique. So this is the schematic diagram, you can say, for the ion exchange chromatography, and the analysis mostly has these components. You have a conical flask or any other container which consists of the charge sample and the buffer solution. This sample is allowed to pass through a tube which goes through a pump, and this pump basically will allow the sample to pass through the column with a certain constant flow rate. So that flow rate is usually maintained depending on how much time we want the separation to take place, or how faster or how slower we want the separation to take place. So after it passes through the pump, the sample is left out at a flow rate and it enters the column. This column, as I said before, it consists of the beads and all of the stationary phase. So it passes through this column. And usually, when we are conducting this technique, the clamp that is there is kept closed so that you have a complete separation to take place. And after some time, after when the separation or when the time when the sample is completely completed or it's completely passed through the column, this clamp is opened and it is allowed to pass through the detector. The detector gives the electrical impulses. It basically works on this spectroscopy, so it will detect the amount of the sample based on its absorbance. So this electrical impulse is given to that of the computer software, which gives us a graph of the sample that has entered the detector. Simultaneously, as the sample passes through the detector, it also is left out and it goes to the sample collector, where you can collect your sample. And this sample collector consists of various tubes depending on the number of proteins that are there. So you'll have different tubes. You can collect them in different tubes and use them for further analysis. So now, as we learned about the working of the ion exchange chromatography technique, we have to know what is the elution technique. So here I've shown that you have three different separated bands, or you can say separated samples that are found or proteins that are found. So here we have this protein. So this protein is at the topmost part. So this means that if this were a anion exchange chromatography technique, this would be highly negatively charged, or this would be intermediate, and this would be positively charged protein sample. Now, since this is separated, we cannot just open out the clamp and allow it to leave out. There has to be sophisticated ways wherein which we are able to so this sample will easily come out, but then the topmost part will not come out that very easily. So there are different methods that are used, and this elution of the samples, for this there are two methods. One is the salting out technique. The salting out technique basically involves a salt solution, and the salt solution is allowed to pass through the column. The salt solution can be of varying any different concentration depending on the sample that is used. And as the salt solution is allowed to enter into the column, as we know, salt converts itself into Na plus and Cl minus ions. So if this was an ion exchange chromatography, the Cl minus would go and it would exchange itself with the negatively charged protein. And if the negatively charged protein is exchanged, it would leave out and be eluted out, and it would easily be able to leave from the column. So this salting out technique, it can be even used for cation exchange. So if you would have this to be the highly positively charged protein, Na plus would come and it would bind with that of the charge groups, and the protein would be eluted out. So this is one technique. The second technique is the pH technique, and it basically works on the similar logic as we discussed for the separation. So in this case, instead of increasing or decreasing the pH, we are going to use a buffer solution that has similar pH to that of the pi of the protein. So if suppose this protein, it's supposed to have a isoelectric point of 5. So if the if this has a 5 isoelectric point, we are going to use a buffer that has the pH of 5. So when this buffer is allowed to pass through the column, it will basically give the protein render the protein to have no charge or zero charge. And then as the protein has zero charge, it obviously won't attach itself with that of the beads or the charge group. So it will be eluted out easily. So after the proteins are eluted out, as discussed earlier, they are passing through a detector, and this detector will give us the through electrical impulse, it will give us the different peaks or different the different absorptions that is there. So usually here on the y-axis you have the absorption, here you have the time for which the separation has taken place, or sorry, the elution has taken place. So depending on that, now here you have, see, since the purple colored protein sample has been eluted first, so you have this graph coming out first. So the more likely this is like a an ion exchange, so the more positively charged would be having a peak first, and then the intermediate would have the peak in the center, and the highly positively charged negatively charged would have the peak in the last. So in this way you can get different graphs or different peaks, and in this way you can analyze or understand the different samples or its charge based on this elution. So that's it for this technique, and thank you so much for listening. Bye bye.